meant more to kids than Jesus did.
Ask what you can do for your
country. One small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
Not because they are easy, but because they are hard.
I have a dream today.
I'm standing here on what is now Rosa Parks Boulevard. In 1967, 40 years ago, it was called 12th Street. And what was racial tension erupted into 4 days of a full-scale racial riots. 41 people were killed, 347 people were injured, 1,300 buildings were burned to the ground, 2,700 businesses ransacked and looted, 5,000 people left homeless. Damage estimated at $500 million. And although race riots were happening all over the country in major cities, Detroit officials said, nah, it'll never happen here.
It's time to stop, children, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going down.
Time magazine wrote about the riots. They said, here was the most sensational expression of an ugly mood of nihilism and anarchy that has ever gripped a small but significant segment of America's minorities. I looked up the word nihilism. It comes from the Latin word nihil that means nothing. It's a philosophical position which argues that the world, especially the past and the current and the future, really has no meaning, no purpose. Nihil meaning nothing. They would argue against any sort of creator God or any outside force that would assign purpose or meaning to anything in life. And nihilism wasn't just an issue among America's minorities. A year earlier, Time magazine's cover story read, God is dead. And so the call of the 60s became free yourself, because many people believed, hey, he was dead. So why follow the rules? Why submit yourself to the ultimate authority?
I think it's time we stop, children, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going down. Imagine there's no heaven. No hell below us, above us only sky.
We've left much of the 60s behind. Gone are the headbands, the psychedelic clothing, the tie-dye clothing. Gone are the bell bottoms and the go-go boots. Gone are the VW minibuses and, even the Beatles didn't last. But the thing that stayed with us is the idea that we don't want anybody telling us what to do, not even God. But Peter warns us in 2 Peter 2:18 and 19, he says, for they mouth empty, boastful words by appealing to the lustful desires of the sinful human nature. They entice people who are just escaping from those who live in error. They promise freedom while they themselves are slaves of depravity. History records that I did it my way, bucking against all authority just didn't really work. Instead of the freedom that everybody was chasing after, so many people found themselves enslaved to sex and drugs and a lifestyle of decadence and depravity. Peter goes on to say, "For a man is a slave to whatever has mastered him." And here we are 4 decades later, still struggling and being in bondage and enslaved to some of those same things. The irony is that the same God that the 60s declared as dead, the God that was supposed to bring all kinds of bondage, the God that we were fighting against His authority, He's the very God that is the source of the freedom that we all long for. It says in 1 Corinthians 3:17, "Now the Lord is Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom." And it's a scary thought to think about giving up control of our lives to somebody else, even God. Maybe that's why there's not a whole lot of difference between people who claim to be Christians and people who don't. George Barna, he does studies all over the country, and well, there's really no difference between the way Christians live their lives and non-Christians. They don't cheat on tests any less. They don't cheat on their taxes any less. They're not more committed to their spouses. Same amount of drug and alcohol addiction between the two groups. Truly, this issue, the issue that started in the 60s about trying to have control for ourselves, this is something we need to talk about today. I want to challenge us, I want to encourage us, that we be a community, that you be a small group, that we be a church that's not about trying to do it all ourselves and have control ourselves, and that we not be a place that says, "I want Jesus just as Savior," but that we take Him as Lord as well. We trust God to be in control of our lives, that we could give Him the keys to the car, let Him sit in the driver's seat, so to speak. I think then we'll see that He can run things a lot better than we can.